Welcome back to The Run Home. Let's get to our biggest guest of the year in size and in reputation. He is an Australian basketball legend. He played with the Chicago Bulls. His name is Luke Longley. Luke, welcome to The Run Home.
Thanks, boys. I'm a little bit worried about your guest list, though. If I'm the biggest reputation you've had on the show, I'm happy with the size bit, and that's for sure. And, you know, fair enough.
Well, you've just given him a bit of ammunition because we did have his current co-owner of the Sydney Kings, Andrew Bogut, also on the show. So just make it clear that was from Paul Hazelby.
I'm happy to stand by that.
Mate, it's a massive couple of days for you, and I imagine it's only going to get bigger once you get on a plane and head over to Chicago, because the Chicago Bulls have now got the Ring of Honour in the class of 2024, the inaugural year. It's honouring your 1995-96 championship team, when 72 wins, 10 losses in the regular season, went on to take it all out, mate. When did you find out the news, and how does it feel knowing that that incredible team, the greatest of all time, is going to be honoured in this way?
Yeah, well, I found out not very long ago, actually. There's been rumblings about it. You know, we've never had a reunion, that team. It's been 25 years, I think, or more, and we've never got together as a group. So I'm actually as excited or more excited about that than I am about the Ring of Honour. But while we're on the Ring of Honour, that's very cool. It's nice to have, you know, it's just nice to be recognised, isn't it? And there's a big flurry about the moment. Everyone's nostalgic about 90s basketball, and I'm just along for the ride.
Why haven't you had the reunion? I know it's commonplace in the AFL. We haven't had a Fremantle Dockers premiership reunion either in my time. But is it commonplace over there in the NBA to have one?
Well, some teams who've never won a championship have reunions every year. I guess those guys must live in the same state. But we've got Croatians and Canadians and Australians and the lot. I don't know. It's a good question. I think, you know, Mike won six championships with six different, basically different groups of guys. So if he had a championship every 6 years, he'd have, you know, he'd have one every six. I beg your pardon. He'd never stop having them. So I guess it's probably part of that. Honestly, Dennis has been doing Dennis things, and Michael's been playing golf, and yeah, I've been in Australia and watching the Dockers play, and yeah, we've all been busy, but it's a bit of a shame. So I'm looking forward to the reunion. I'm looking forward to the reunion before the reunion is what I'm looking forward to.
What about some of the players? You mentioned Mike there, but you know, you got to know them so well, and even recently you hosted Scottie Pippen. Do you keep in contact with many of them? And follow-up question, what was that time like with Scottie?
So yeah, I keep in touch with quite a few. Not all of them, but sometimes, you know, sometimes time erodes, but I think we'd all be happy to see each other again. I speak to Randy Brown regularly, Steve Kerr, obviously, Phil, Judd, some of the other guys I haven't kept in touch with as much. It was great to catch up with Pip down here. He loved Australia. He'd been here 2 days. He's talking about getting immigration and can he live here. And, you know, you can walk down the street and it's safe, and the people are beautiful and friendly. And he loved it. He absolutely loved it. So it's good to see him grinning from ear to ear, because he's been a grumpy bugger lately. So it was good to see him enjoying himself.
Let's talk a little bit more about that 1995-96 team. 72 wins, 10 losses, like I mentioned before. But you started 37-0 at home and a 44-game winning streak, because you got to include some of the games from the previous season. What are your recollections of that season in particular? I know you won three NBA championships, but that year, what stood out the most, or a few of the memories?
Well, as a testament to my poor recollection, Dame, I didn't know that we had a 37-game winning streak. I've forgotten that. So anecdotes are rough for me. I'm getting old. But what I do remember, mate, the only time it's ever happened to me, and it'll never will have happened to Hayes, is it might have happened to you. We would walk out to the court at the beginning of the game, and the other team literally had punched the clock. Like, you could tell that they weren't interested. So we intimidated people before the game even got going, and that sounds like a big boast, but it was we really steamrolled people that year, and some teams didn't want to have anything to do with us.
Luke, I remember the first time you and I met, you were kind enough to invite me around. The Wildcats were on the road. I was injured. We watched the game together, but there was not one bit of memorabilia or merchandise in your house. Now, you did recently go through a fire where you lost some of it, but you're so humble and down to earth. But I asked you, of everything you've ever had that's come out from the Bulls or that you've been awarded, what do you, you know, pride the most? And it was something that burnt down. It was a photo, I believe, from the New York Times. Do you remember what that photo was, and why was it so meaningful to you?
It's a good question, mate. I don't collect the memorabilia, and most of it did burn. Some of it actually survived because it was out in the shed. But there was Annie Leibovitz took a photo of our team, and she positioned us strangely. She had Michael wasn't in the middle, and I was not unusually sort of up the back and out of the way, and Dennis was off to the side. But they put it on the cover of the New York Times magazine, and don't forget New York were our mortal enemies, a little bit like Sydney and Perth. Or West Coast and Fremantle, put us on the cover of the New York Times, and the caption down the bottom said, "The best stop ever, stop anywhere." And I thought that was a pretty cool boast. And so that was the one piece of memorabilia I had in the house, and that burned in the fire. But since then, I got Stevie Kerr to get a digital replica of his original, and now I have a digital replica, which they're still the only piece of memorabilia I really have on my wall. Obviously, my rings. I've been flashing them around lately. I'm suddenly everywhere. I'm doing a partnership with Hahn, a half court, half pub partnership with Hahn, and they got my rings out there. You'll see that. That's on its way. But that's definitely my favourite piece of nostalgia.
Luke set us up, and I'll tell you a couple of times he got me good, but we actually invited him in. I think it was Rob Beveridge asked if he'd come and address the playing group. And the idea was, you know, talk about championships and how amazing it feels when you win one. And we're all excited. Luke Longley's coming into practice, and we believe he's going to bring a championship ring. And so he's told us the story of whatever year it was with the ring he brought along, reached into his pocket and said, "Guys, do you want to see the ring?" And we're like, "Yeah, of course." And he opened this thing. It was just a metal ring, quite chunky. And we're all trying to be polite. Like, "Oh, that's nice, Luke." But set us up good. Then he pulled out the one that was full of diamonds. Steve Kerr, you mentioned his name before. What was he like as a player? And now what do you see in him as a coach that you knew back then would lead him to be one of the greatest coaches in the modern day era?
So I had no idea back then he was going to be a great coach. Steve does have a deep, crazy deep competitive streak that, you know, catches you by surprise often. He swinging on MJ in practice demonstrated that, but didn't surprise any of us because he was, you know, he's got a bit of redhead in him, a bit of the unfair advantage comes out now and again. But he was also really dedicated to what he did. You know, he shot and shot and shot and shot. When I first met Steve, I'd never shot the ball outside of the paint, really, a little turnaround jumper. But we figured out that we needed to stretch Shaq out a little bit. And so I decided to reinvent myself as a stretch five, which in those days meant shooting a 15-footer. Didn't even consider a three-pointer. So I said to Steve, you know, "Look, get me a 15-footer, mate." And I spent the summer and we built a 15-foot jumper. And that's ended up being why I was in pick and roll with MJ so much. And, you know, for Steve, it was just a question of bolting me onto with workouts here. He did, but we're in the gym twice a day for the whole summer, and he was just a workaholic. And I guess he's taken that to coaching, and coaching is so much about preparation. And the other thing it's about, obviously, is relating to the players, and he was always, he's good at that. He gets on with everyone. He's a nice guy. He's a thoughtful guy, generous guy. So meticulous and thoughtful were a pretty good starting point to be a 10-time world champion, as it turns out, for Steve.
Was there a noticeable difference when you got to the Chicago Bulls in the way that they prepared and the way they went about things compared to some of the other clubs you played for?
Yeah, well, they certainly did it better than, you know, than the Perth Wildcats or the Perth Wildcats or the Redbacks. But I'd been in Minnesota and we've been practicing so I moved to Timberwolves. I've got to the NBA. I think it's a big league. I get there and we're practicing in a public gym, like a membership-based public gym, and you've got to elbow Barry to get onto the elbow Barry off the bench press machine, and you've got to chase the kids off the court when you want to get some shots, and very, very sort of public situation. You have a bad game when the guy on the treadmill while you're doing the bikes, you're talking shit to you, and I'm sorry, I should stop swearing on your radio show. So then I moved to Chicago, and you walk in, and there's, you know, there's an army of strength coaches and a tsunami of massage therapists, and there's more rebounders and tossbacks, and there's six baskets you can help yourself to, and there's championship banners, and there's trophies in the cabinet, and everything's red, white, and black, and you've got security on the door, and just a whole different level of services and facilities, first of all. Second of all, the first nearly half an hour of practice was without a ball. It was all spacing, timing, footwork, loosening up, obviously. But I was really intrigued by that, how much emphasis was on the real fundamentals of the game. And I'm sure it's the same with footy, Hayes, but in basketball, it's all about spacing and timing. And we practiced that without the ball. That was probably the glaring thing for me, and the attention to detail. So, yeah, it was a whole different experience and one I loved.
When you're a member of the Order of Australia, we don't mind you dropping the occasional S-bomb, so that's totally fine. But I can't believe your three NBA championships you put ahead of your two Australian State League championships with the mighty Perth Redbacks. I want to touch on the spacing and not using a basketball, different concepts. You are an owner now of the Sydney Kings. Have you brought across any of those training techniques that you had as a player that maybe you shared with the players, or do you step right away when it comes to the on-court stuff currently with the Kings?
So with the coaches, it's certainly not my job to tell the coaches how to coach. But when we, with the Kings, when we hire the coaches, we're certainly looking at a style of basketball that we want to play that's entertaining. Well, first of all, that we think can win, because winning's entertaining. Secondly, that we think's fun to watch and that we think's modern and that translates into the NBA for the guys that are trying to make that transition. So those are the things. And obviously, we're not executing very well, but that's certainly part of it. So no, I don't get involved with telling the coach how to coach. I do get involved with the guys that want help and in whatever capacity I can. I love that. I love to get on the tools, so to speak. But I'm only in Sydney a week a month, or probably less now, actually. So I let the coaches do the coaching.
How would you go now if you're starting your career now in the NBA? We know it's a bit different. It's all about shooting. We've seen that with Ben Simmons. But for you going into the comp now, how do you think you'd go?
Yeah, mate, I reckon the Luke from 95 would struggle because I didn't have a three-pointer and probably a bit on the slow side, more of a wrestler than a sprinter. These days you need sprinters and shooters. Those days you definitely needed an ogre down in the cave down the bottom there. But I'd like to back myself that if I was a young bloke today, I would go out and teach myself a three-pointer or get someone to teach me. I mean, if it's a skill acquisition thing, I was always good at acquiring skills, so I just acquired that one. It just didn't even occur to me back then that was, I often kicked myself. I didn't tell Steve to build me a three-point shot. Like, it would have been really great to stretch Shaq all the way out there. So I think I'd go all right, mate, but I think my foot speed would probably be the thing that would hold me back. I'd say that.
I wish I had Steve Kerr to teach me a three-point shot. I once was playing for Luke. He was the assistant coach with the Boomers. And we'd have a bit of banter between the two of us. And during warm-up of an Aussie game, I made back-to-back threes. Now, this is warm-up, so no defense.
No pressure.
After I made the second one, I looked at Luke and gave him a little look. And he goes, "What, mate, even a broken clock's right twice a day." So it brought me back to reality. But you mentioned that relationship. That's all right. I've clearly moved on from it. You mentioned that relationship you have with players. And that's one thing I took for granted at times, but then in hindsight I'm so grateful for with that Australian Boomers connection, because if Luke called you up to play a game of backgammon, you'd go up there just think, "Oh, okay, sweet, I like this game, it'll be a bit of fun," but then you left as a better person. So there'd be a bit of talk around basketball but more about life, which was brilliant. And it leads me to my next question: are you gonna have backgammon set up at the Denmark Hotel, because I believe you're now an owner of this beautiful landmark building?
You're a mind reader, Damo, amongst all of your other qualities. You're a mind reader. So, yeah, there's some rooms up the top which we're trying to figure out what to do with. They're small, they're tight, and I'd like to get a couple of backgammon boards up into there so that we can all be better people. Because obviously everyone's a better person when they play backgammon. And there's a great balcony out there for having a han. So, yes, we're going to do that for sure.
Is there any truth to the story that your chef is named Michael Jordan?
Mate, it's absolutely hand on heart true. He's bald. he's got a shaved head. And he's got he's got good lateral movement between the pans. And look, I couldn't believe it myself when they told me, but I introduced myself to him and we had a bit of a chuckle, and he sees the humour in it, and he's from, I think he's British originally, so he's, you know, he's pretty light compared to MJ, so he's like the negative image, if you like, or what, I don't know how to frame it. Anyway. He's Michael Jordan, and he's cooking in my restaurant, and he's doing great.
Oh, that is so brilliant. Last one before we let you go. I've got to ask you about your Fremantle Dockers, because you are a former number one ticket holder for the club. What are your memories of a young Paul Hazelby out there?
Well, it's funny. I was saying to you before the show, and I know you set one up for me, Damo, but I told him I missed him. We needed a ball magnet like him on the field. Like, he was... I loved watching Hayes play in his day, and I did say it was amazing how many balls he could end up gathering without moving that far at all. So that was just that shows you the mercurial talent of the man.
Between us, mate, we'd have a good running race, I reckon.
Right. You could get me going backwards, mate, no doubt.
I'll get you now. Good on you, Luke. We do appreciate you joining us for a bit of time here on the run home, and well done on another well-deserved accolade.
Thanks, man. Good on you. Thanks, guys.
Luke Longley, what a star he has been. And that is a good thing to have bestowed on you, the Ring of Honour team, 95-96. He's come a long way with the Sydney Kings. Now, it hurts a little bit to see him there, but what a story it has been.
Look, we just don't have enough time on the show to go through all his accolades. And I love, this is Luke to a T, of everything he's achieved, what he's looking forward to most is just catching up with old teammates. It's the people side of it that kept him going. He is a people person, even though he's also a bit of a recluse at times. But when he puts himself out there, you go away a better person with any minute you get to spend with Luke. So love that he's come on, and just over the moon that they're acknowledging, in my opinion, the greatest NBA team of all time.
Joining any time on the Temperate Bedshed text machine, 0487 736 736, or call the Kia open line, 13 12 55 for Kia. Morley Kia, get more.